Hello everyone. So welcome to session 7 of IAS Baba's rapid revision series of 500 high probable topic for prelims 2020. I'm Pritham Reddy and I'll be dealing 15 important topics crucial for prelims examination this year. In yesterday's session there were some corrections and clarifications, and also in session number 3 topic 31 I had discussed that right to vote is a part of fundamental rights under subclause article 19 subclause 1A. I think like the content I picked from 2020 judgment. However, I'm not finding that particular source. So for time being, let's consider right to vote as a constitutional right. And in session 6, there were few mistakes. So topic number 80, inner line permit, I had missed to add Manipur, which was recently added in 2020. And also inner line permit is issued by the concerned states. So I had told inner line permit is issued by Government of India. So it is issued by the concerned states. And in topic number 82, bond challenge, 6th point, I had told that India had revised its recent target to restore the degraded land to 26 million hectares. So I had provided 23 million hectares in the PDF, like there was a typo. However, I have changed it in the recent updated PDF. Okay, so it is 26 million hectares by 2030. That is by 2020, India had decided that it will restore around 13 million hectares, and which is already done. And the recent revised target is another 13 million hectares by 2030. So both including 26 million hectares by 2030. And also during discussing topic number 86, marine turtles, I said almost all the marine turtles are part of IUCN vulnerable. However, there are two marine turtles, and we'll be dealing with the rest of the marine turtles today, which two marine turtles don't have IUCN vulnerable. So they have one is critically endangered and another one is endangered. The rest of the marine turtles are vulnerable. So the first marine turtle is the loggerhead. So yesterday we had already dealt with olive ridley and leatherback. So loggerhead turtle is also a vulnerable, and it is protected under Schedule 1 Wildlife Protection Act 1972. And these loggerhead turtles are widely distributed throughout the world, and they are usually found in Atlantic, Pacific, Indian Ocean, as well as Mediterranean Sea. Okay, the loggerhead, they got its name due to their large heads that support powerful jaw muscles, which allows them to crush hard shelled prey. Okay, that's the reason they got this name, loggerheads. And the nesting beaches of this loggerheads are under threat due to tourism development. Okay, and one important thing what we have to know is the loggerhead sea turtle has a low reproductive rate. Okay, that's why it becomes important to protect this species. And also loggerheads, yesterday I told, except the loggerhead, all the remaining four species nest along the Indian coast. So loggerheads don't lay eggs on the Indian coast. Next important turtle is hawksbill marine turtle. So it is critically endangered under IUCN, and also it is protected under Schedule 1 Wildlife Protection Act. Even hawksbill has wildlife distribution, however it is found mostly or abundantly in warm tropical waters, and it is found in Indian Ocean, Pacific Ocean and Atlantic Ocean. So of all the sea turtle species, hawksbill is the one most associated with warm tropical water. You have to remember this. And one unique characteristics about this hawksbill turtle is it has shown bifluorescent characteristics, and it is the first reptile recorded with this characteristic. And scientists are yet to prove what is the exact reason for this biofluorescent characteristics. Okay, so next important turtle is green marine turtle, and it is endangered. It has been listed endangered by both IUCN and CITES, and this green marine turtle is also widely distributed and especially found in tropical and subtropical waters of Atlantic, Pacific Ocean and Indian Ocean. See, marine turtles this year is important because recently World Turtle Day was observed on 23rd May 2020, and also the theme Adopt Don't Shop. At the same time, top sea turtle experts during this World Turtle Day, top sea turtle experts from around the globe, they discovered that almost half, that is 45% of the world's threatened sea turtle population, they are found in the northern Indian Ocean. Okay, at the same time, in the CMS, you saw, right, in the column art, in the logo, we can see marine turtles. And we'll see why this Olive Ridley and Leatherback is important in a future session, like I'll be dealing with that. Okay, so Central Asian Flyway Action Plan is the next important topic. So Central Asian Flyway Action Plan. Okay, we already read yesterday regarding the COP13 Convention to Migratory Species. So during COP13 Convention to Migratory Species, which was held in Gandhinagar, India, India assumed presidency of UN body on migratory species for 3 years. Also, India announced that it has prepared national action plan to achieve this particular Central Asian Flyway Action Plan. Okay, so India said it has prepared a national action plan to achieve Central Asian Flyway Action Plan for the conservation of migratory water birds and their habitats. Okay, so that's the reason it becomes important to know about the Central Asian Flyway Action Plan. So according to the national action plan, India said the concerned states, okay, wherever this migratory water birds and habitats are found, so those concerned states should promote conservation of such species. Okay, and second point is the national action plan says that the concerned states should build on and complement programs and actions that are already being taken by the center to promote conservation. Okay, and also the concerned state should build and complement action plans that have been already followed by certain important international conventions such as BirdLife International, IUCN, WWF, Ramsar, Convention on Biodiversity, UNEP, World Bank, etc. Okay, and it is important that what areas come under this Central Asian Flyway Action Plan. So usually wherever the species, migratory species, which are included in Appendix 1 of Convention to Migratory Species. Okay, so if there are species which are listed Appendix 1 of Convention to Migratory Species, okay, or where species which are listed as threatened in Threatened Birds of the World issued by BirdLife International, or wherever the population of certain species which number less than around 10,000 individuals, they come under the part of implementation of like CAF, that is Central Asian Flyway Action Plan. And we have to note few important points, that is during the COP13 CMS, India said it is home to several migratory species such as snow leopard, Amur falcons, bar-headed geese, black-necked cranes, marine turtles, dugongs, humpback whales, etc. But what is more important is Union Environment Minister, he announced in the CMS that 7 species were identified for conservation and recovery action program. So these 7 species become important. So out of 7, dugong, and then white shark or whale shark, so dugong, whale shark, and marine turtles, especially the Olive Ridley and Leatherback, okay, these 3 have been added to the conservation and recovery action program. That's the reason I said marine turtles, especially Olive Ridley and Leatherback, are important. And apart from these 3, 4 new species were added to this recovery programs for critically endangered species list. Okay, so we will be dealing with those things. So recovery program for critically endangered species. So currently we have 21 critically endangered species added to this particular list. So earlier we had 17, so now 4 new is added. So those 4 new species are northern river terrapin, clouded leopard, Arabian sea humpback whale, red panda. Already we have covered humpback whale, already we have covered marine turtles, right? So we'll be dealing with other species in future sessions. So just remember 4 important topics. So you should have revised all these endangered animals. Okay, now this recovery program for critically endangered species is part of IDWH, that is Integrated Development of Wildlife Habitat. So this recovery program for critically endangered species is part of this IDWH, and National Board of Wildlife adds the critically endangered species to this particular list or to the recovery program. Okay, so we'll just see once what all are the important species which are already listed. So snow leopard, bustard, dolphin, hangul, Nilgiri tar, marine turtles, dugongs, swiftlet, Asian wild buffalo, Nicobar megapod, Manipur bro, antelope deer, vultures, Malabar civet, Indian rhinoceros, Asiatic lion, swamp deer, Jordan's courser. See, usually in previous year question papers, whenever UPSC used to ask certain endangered species, they were picked from these lists only. So whichever year they ask certain species, so that year maybe those species were added or some reference were there. Okay, so this year I am expecting and predicting these four species can come like question paper. Okay, so just read and revise if you have already done notes. So next important topic is 96th one, that is integrated development of wildlife habitat. So this integrated wildlife development of wildlife habitat, it's a centrally sponsored scheme and major aim is that it provides technical and financial assistance to the states and UTs for protection of wildlife habitat. So I was telling during the central action flyway action plan that states, concerned states, should promote conservation, they should protect habitats. Okay, so for them the technical and financial assistance is provided by this integrated development of wildlife habitat. It's a centrally sponsored scheme and it will provide technical and financial assistance. Three important components we have to know about this integrated development of wildlife habitat. Okay, so it provides financial and technical assistance to protected areas. And one important point to note is all the protected areas in different states or UTs are eligible for assistance except those areas which receive assistance under Project Tiger. So the funds which is already released by Project Tiger or the assistance given by them, so except those protected areas, all other protected areas in different states are eligible for the assistance. So second important thing is protection of wildlife outside protected areas. So it also gives assistance to the wildlife habitats which fall outside the network of protected areas. And under this components, funds are granted against biodiversity plans prepared by chief wildlife wardens of those respective states. At the same time, priority is given to regions which is the buffer zone to the protected areas also. Okay, and third important thing, recovery program for critically endangered habitat and species. So we saw this recovery program for critically endangered species and habitats. So IDWH will provide funds and technical assistance even to this particular recovery program for critically endangered habitats and species. Okay, and it provides funds also to the Project Tiger, Project Elephant, development of wildlife habitats, etc. Okay, next important topic is 97, that is Parliamentary Budgetary Office. Okay, so Parliamentary Budgetary Office was in news often because they were telling that we need this independent and impartial body. Okay, so they were telling that it is high time that India needs this Parliamentary Budgetary Office, and we will know about this Parliamentary Budget Office. So this Parliament Budget Office will act as an independent impartial body which is linked directly to the Parliament. And major objective is to provide technical and objective analysis of budget and public finance. Okay, see, this work is almost done already by Auditor General. However, the experts, and there were many articles dealing with why India needs Parliamentary Budgetary Office, which acts as an independent and impartial body to provide technical and objective analysis of budgets and public finance. So this Parliamentary Budgetary Office will help to generate quality public debate on budget policy and public finance. So it enables the parliamentarians to engage meaningfully in budget process. Okay, so parliamentarians can engage in some meaningful discussion and healthy discussion regarding the quality of the public, like public finance and budget. Okay, and traditionally, like, independent budgetary units are more common in developed countries. So now there is a demand that developing countries should also have such independent like body. Okay, at the same time, in India, executive led budgetary governance has not been successful in India. Okay, so this makes it important to know about the Parliamentary Budgetary Office, and at the same time regarding the Auditor General. So if you haven't revised Auditor General, go and revise that one. Okay, Auditor General provides retrospective audits and analysis of the financial accounts and performance of the government operations. At the same time, like, we can compare AG with PBO. So PBO will provide prospective forward-looking economic and fiscal projections as well as policy costings. Okay, So this is what like Auditor General doesn't do. Okay, so Auditor General is usually it deals with retrospective audits and analysis of the financial accounts and performance of the government operation, and an independent and technical body such as like Parliamentary Budgetary Office can help to provide forward-looking economic and fiscal projections. Okay, so next important topic is role of governor during hung assembly. Okay, this is very important because we saw the case in Madhya Pradesh. Okay, and there have been lot of political crises, so we already dealt with anti-defection law. Okay, so we'll see what is the role of governor during hung assembly. So you have to remember Article 163 regarding this. Okay, so Constitution envisages that the governor should act on the aid and advice of Council of Ministers, except in those situations in which he, by or under the Constitution, required to act in his discretion. So this is what the Article 163 says. So Article 163 in simple says governor should act on the aid and advice of Council of Ministers, and he can act in his discretion wherever the Constitution provides for it. Okay, so Article 163 obviously you would have read, and what is like there are many discretionary powers for governor. So what is important with this topic is whenever there is no party which gets a clear majority, so governor has discretion to choose a candidate for chief minister. So we know that governor is the one who appoints the chief minister. So whenever there is no clear cut majority, so whenever there is no party which gets a clear cut majority, so governor has discretion to choose a candidate for chief minister who will put together a majority coalition as soon as possible. Okay, so that's the reason, and many times this provision has been misused and has lot of confusion. Okay, so what is the preferred order you should be knowing? So usually governor may invite the leaders of the largest single party first. So you people might be knowing, as soon as elections are done, usually governor will invite the leader of the largest single party first, right? So the leader of that largest single party, so that will be the first president. Later on, however, if it is clear that the largest single party has no potential ally or enough independent members to ensure a majority, then the governor may invite the leader of the largest pre-poll combination or alliance. Okay, so it's like coalition government. So you can call the leader of a coalition or an alliance. Okay, if there is no combination or such alliance, governor may invite leaders one by one in the order of their size in the new assembly. Okay, so he will be inviting leaders one by one, and during this process a post-poll combination may emerge. If any one of them agrees to form a government, then the government may insist on letters of support from those outside the leader's party who are willing to join or extend support to him. Okay, so this is how the order is followed. So governor may invite the leader of the largest single party first. If in case there is no single party, and like if the single party doesn't have the potential candidate and or ally, okay, then the governor can call other leaders of the largest pre-poll combination or alliance. Okay, if even such combination or alliance is not found, then governor may invite leaders one by one in the order of their size in the new assembly, and finally he can identify someone, and if everyone agrees, okay, so governor may also insist on letters of support from outside of the leader's party, so that if everyone willing, whether other parties are willing to join them and extend support to him. Okay, so you can read about the role of governor during hung assembly and governor powers. Okay, and also you should know Sarkaria Commission has also given some recommendations. So as general principles, Sarkaria Commission says governor should look for a party or combination that commands the widest support in the assembly, and that his task is to see that a government is formed and not to try to form a government which will pursue policies which he approves. Okay, so governor can't simply name some puppet or like some particular leader from some party who can follow whatever the policies which the governor says. Okay, this is what the Sarkaria Commission says, that governor should always look for a party of combination or command the widest support in the assembly. So Article 174, so governor summons the House only on the advice of Council of Ministers. So you have to remember this Article 174 also. So Governor summons the House usually on the advice of Council of Ministers, but okay, there is one constitutional right that if in case the Governor believes that there is a doubt about the incumbent's majority, okay, only then the Governor can interfere into this particular decision. But usually Governor summons the House only on the advice of Council of Ministers, okay, but will be within his constitutional rights to cause the House to be convened if there is reason to believe that there is doubt about the incumbent's majority. Okay, so next important topic is delimitation. So recently there are a lot of articles regarding that the delimitation commission should be set up, and the number of seats in Lok Sabha or the even in certain assembly should be increased. So we'll try to read about delimitation. So delimitation is the act of redrawing boundaries of Lok Sabha and state assembly seats to represent changes in the population. Okay, the main objective of delimitation is to provide equal representation to equal segments of a population. Okay, so in simple words, it aims at a fair division of geographical areas so that one political party doesn't have an advantage over others in an election. Okay, and few important facts we have to remember: that delimitation is carried out by an independent delimitation commission. Okay, and the constitution mandates that its orders, that is the independent delimitation commission's orders, are final and cannot be questioned before any court. Okay, and we'll see regarding how delimitation is carried out. So usually Article 82 constitution empowers the parliament to make a law. So parliament had enacted delimitation act, and parliament also, constitution provides that parliament should enact delimitation act after every census. Okay, so the commission the parliament enacts delimitation act after every census, so union government set up a delimitation commission, and usually this delimitation commission is made up of retired Supreme Court judge, chief election commissioner, and respective state election commissioners. Okay, so you can, simple question can come that delimitation commission is set up by parliament, president, election commission, or union government. So usually union government, so delimitation act provides that union government will set up the delimitation commission, and you should know who all are the what is the composition of this delimitation commission. Okay, and also it is important to remember that last delimitation exercise, which started in July 2002 and completed on May 31, 2008, was based on the 2001 census and only readjusted boundaries of existing Lok Sabha and assembly seats and reworked the numbers of reserved seats. Okay, so next important topic of the day is presidential pardoning powers. So we know that Article 72 says that the president shall have powers to grant pardons, reprieves, respites, remissions, etc. So we have to know Article 72 deals with the pardoning powers of the president. Okay, so we'll see the different definition of the pardoning powers, like commutation, pardon, remission, respite, reprieve. So commutation deals with reducing the punishment by changing the nature of the punishment. Okay, so usually commutation deals with reducing the punishment by changing the nature of the punishment. For example, punishment to death may be changed to life imprisonment. Okay, so it deals with the reducing punishment, but important thing is it changes the nature of the punishment. So next important topic is pardon. So pardon removes both the sentence and the conviction and completely absolves the convict from all the sentences, punishments, etc. Okay, so pardon is easy, it totally removes both the sentence and the conviction. Okay, now remission and commutation are confusing because they both are almost same. So this one, remission will reduce the period of sentence but without changing the character of the punishment. So in commutation, the nature of the punishment or the character of the punishment is changed, but in remission, the period of sentence is reduced, however the punishment character is not changed. So next important thing is respite. So in respite, it denotes awarding a lesser sentence in place of one or originally awarded due to some special fact, such as maybe the convict is physically disabled or the convict is pregnant. So like for such special cases, the president can provide respite, that is, he can award a lesser sentence in place of one originally awarded. Next is reprieve. Okay, so reprieve, so here it implies a stay of the execution of a sentence. So especially, for example, we can deal with death sentence. Okay, so the president can stay that execution for a temporary period. So it will enable the convict to have time to seek pardon or commutation from the president. Okay, so reprieve, respite, remission, pardon, commutation, all these are some of the powers which president shall have according to Article 72. So next important topic is saral. So saral, simple thing they can ask, what is saral associated with? So saral means state rooftop solar attractiveness index. Okay, so state rooftop solar attractiveness index, and this saral index evaluates Indian states based on their attractiveness for rooftop development. Okay, and this saral index is designed collaboratively by the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, Shakti Sustainable Energy Foundation, and Associated Chambers of Commerce and Industry of India. So just remember that it is a saral is a evaluate, like it is an index which evaluates Indian states based on their attractiveness for rooftop development. And saral currently captures 5 key aspects. So this index will capture 5 key aspects, that is, robustness of policy framework, implementation environment, investment climate, consumer experience, business ecosystem, etc. And the index would incentivize rooftop solar by creating healthy competition among the states. So you should also remember that India had set a target of around 175 gigawatts of renewable energy capacity by 2022, of which 100, so we had set 175 gigawatt by 2022, right, renewable energy, in which like 100 is 100 gigawatt is from solar power, right? So by 2022 India aims to achieve 100 gigawatt solar power, and this particular saral will also help. Okay, so Karnataka has been placed at the first rank in saral index, so you can remember that one. And next important government scheme is Nishta. Okay, so Nishta was recently launched by Human Resource Development Ministry. Okay, so it was launched by Union Human Resource Development Ministry, and this Nishta, that is National Mission to Improve Learning Outcomes at Elementary Level, is the world's largest teachers training program. Okay, it aims to build capacities of 42 lakh government teachers across the country. Okay, so the major aim is to improve the teachers' quality. Okay, so teachers will develop their skills on various aspects related to learning outcomes, school safety and security, etc. Okay, and major objective is to motivate and equip teachers to encourage and foster critical thinking in the students, right? So teachers will play a huge role. So that's the reason this Nishta aims to improve, motivate and equip the teachers to encourage and foster critical thinking in students. So next important scheme is Sabka Vishwas scheme. So Sabka Vishwas scheme deals with the dispute resolution scheme. So this was like recently announced during 2019-20 budget, and it was operational during September 1 till December 31, 2019. And it had main two components. One is the dispute resolution and the other is the amnesty. Okay. See, this Sabka Vishwas scheme was launched so that the taxpayers don't face some tax litigation. Okay. So the dispute resolution component was aimed at liquidating the legacy cases of central excise and central tax that are subsumed in GST and the pending in litigation at various forums. Okay. So this particular Sabka Vishwas scheme provides substantial relief in the tax duties for all the categories of cases, and also it aimed at reducing the tax litigation and improve ease of doing business. So simple thing they can ask, Sabka Vishwas scheme was associated with what? So it is a dispute resolution scheme, and to reduce tax litigation and improve ease of doing business. Okay, and especially it will help for the businesses to grow during the economic downturn. So next important topic is Golden Jubilee celebration of Vivekananda Rock Memorial. So this Vivekananda Rock Memorial, so it is 50th foundation year, and it is a monument in Kanyakumari, that is Tamil Nadu, and it is at the tri-junction of Indian Ocean, Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea at the Lakshadweep Sea. Okay, so Lakshadweep Sea near the tri-junction. Okay, so this Vivekananda Rock Memorial is located in that particular tri-junction of Indian Ocean, Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, and it was built in 1970 in order to honor Swami Vivekananda, okay, who is said to have attained enlightenment at this place prior to his famous Chicago trip. Okay, so we can remember about this Vivekananda Memorial, where it is located, and also a scheme Ek Bharat Vijay Bharat was announced, okay, by this Kanyakumari based Vivekananda Kendra and its state. Okay, it launched a year-long nationwide contact program called this Ek Bharat Vijay Bharat. Okay, and the major aim of this mass contact program is to spread the messages of Swami Vivekananda. So we can expect a question on Swami Vivekananda also, so it's better if you people read about him. And next important topic is Chilika Lake and Ansupa Lake. So you have to know about the Chilika Lake and the Ansupa Lake. These were in news because recently Odisha Wetland Authority approved implementation of an integrated management plan to conserve and protect this habitat around the Chilika and Ansupa Lake. Okay, so I was talking about the CMS convention to the migratory species. So Chilika Lake, Odisha government wetland authority, right, it approved the implementation of an integrated management plan for this. And we should know about the Chilika. So Chilika is country's largest brackish water lagoon. Okay, and also it is located on the east coast of Odisha near the mouth of the Daya River. Okay, and it has one of the largest, you know, migratory species. Okay, so this particular Chilika acts as a hotspot of biodiversity with more than 1 million overwintering migratory species. So Chilika has the distinction of being one of only two lagoons which also has this globally endangered Irrawaddy dolphins. Okay, so these two are important. Also, this Chilika Lake was granted the first Indian wetland of international importance under Ramsar Convention. Okay, so this Chilika Lake was identified by the Ramsar Convention, and it was first to get the Indian wetland of international importance tag. Okay, so now we might have already read Chilika Lake. Remember Ansupa Lake, it is also in the Odisha, and it is Odisha's largest freshwater lake, and it is famous for sweet water fish and also 32 species of migratory birds. Okay, so these are the important topics. And also you can remember Irrawaddy dolphin, it is IUCN endangered. Okay, and usually Irrawaddy dolphin is found in India, Bangladesh and some Southeast Asia, that is Mekong River, okay, and the Ganges River and Irrawaddy river system. And usually Irrawaddy dolphins are found in Chilika Lake, and so I said it is the second lagoon and the first one is the Sundarbans. So usually Irrawaddy dolphin is found in Chilika and Sundarbans. So these are the topics for the day. Okay, we'll meet with another 15 important topics in next session. Thank you for watching. Do subscribe and do comment.